In the Rocky Mountains, we have more than enough gorgeous vistas to enjoy. From the majestic peaks of the Gore Range to the glistening creeks on the valley floor, beauty surrounds us. But this beauty isn't confined to the outdoors. The valley is home to several galleries which house magnificent pieces of work by talented artists from near and far. Hi, I'm Tricia Swenson. In the next half hour, we'll introduce you to the places and the people who will expand your horizons beyond our scenic vistas. Let's go on a gallery stroll. No matter what the weather's like outside, the colorful works at Peace Art Gallery will brighten your day. Come on, let's learn more about glass art. Hi, Ava.
Hello. Oh, welcome.
Good to see you.
Very nice to see you.
Ava was the director of the Pismo Fine Art Glass Gallery for many years, 13 years.
Exactly.
But now Peace Art Gallery is your own. This is in your blood, glass art.
That exactly is right. I grew up in a glass-making family, and glass is really one of the most interesting medium to me, and I love it, and I just want to show you around a little bit.
Well, let's take a look. Just a few examples right
exactly.
here.
Exactly, and if you think in glass is just sand, fire, and human breath, that's what you how you create glass. And imagine all these pieces, very different looking, very different shapes, and very different technique making the, you know, that particular piece. So this, for example, has 35 sheets of glass, and artist paints on each individual pane and just creates this wonderful object, which looks like it's one solid object, but it's just, you know, constructed piece. So the other example of different technique, which is fusing, would be this piece. And it is 9,000 strands of glass fused together. And these intricate colors come from just really adding different metallic oxides in glass. Different metallic oxides will give you the green, different will give you the red. And on a different technique, this is typical blown glass with using old Italian technique called Murini. So the artists have to create those tiny little glass beads with this little detail work, and then pick it up and blows it into this wonderful, wonderful shape. So,
and mosaic, that's one of the purest forms of a glass art, right?
That's right. Mosaic, for example, we have it right here. Those are 3 millimeter diameter glass dots the artist puts on the glass sheet. And it is a wonderful example. As you said, it's a very ancient technique, one of the first techniques where we recognize glass as an art form.
Okay, well, let's take a look at the rest of the gallery.
Okay, let's do it.
Ava, there's so much color that can be found with glass art in your gallery, but there's also beauty with an absence of color.
This is such a perfect fit for our environment here. Trees and a very muted coloring, and see how much drama you can achieve. And then if we look in a little further, this is representation of the most technical what you can find in glass, because this gentleman, his name is Richard Royal, is the master of glass blowing in the United States. He was there at the beginning of everything happening, and look at the wonderful color and the technique, and I am so glad actually I could represent his work here.
And you're starting to carry some other mediums.
I did bring an artist from Colorado, and she works in clay. These are also bronze castings. And besides this, I also focus on the two-dimensional work, and I do have some great paintings by Polish artist Adam Wator. And talking about Polish art, we do have this extravaganza. It is a very whimsical combination of bronze and ceramics, and they are just wonderful pieces which will put a smile on your face, will give you a good day start.
Well, and that's the thing about glass art. It is so whimsical and so fun to look at, and there's so many different subject matters. And even just gift items, whether it's an ornament or the jewelry, this really is wearable art.
Yes, and it is. Look at this piece. It's very sculptural, but of course it would look so good with your evening dress because it makes such a classy, great statement.
Yes, yeah, a real statement piece. Well, Ava, it's been so fun to see the gallery and learn about the glass art and the techniques.
You know, we are so passionate about glass and we would love to talk everybody about it. So please visit and we'll tell you all about this magic medium.
At 12 and a half feet tall, this 7,000 pound tribute to the men who trained at nearby Camp Hale and served in the 10th Mountain Division of the U.S. Army during World War II is the most photographed piece of art in Vail. Many of the members of the 10th Mountain Division went on to create the outdoor industry as we know it today. Art is emotional and personal. Art elicits a response and starts a dialogue and can oftentimes spark friendships. For the past 30 years, the Vickers family has created long-lasting relationships with their clientele and the artists they represent. Let's meet John Vickers at Vail Village Arts. Hi, John. Great to see you. Congratulations, Vail Village Arts. Been here 30 years. What's the secret?
I don't think there is a secret. We don't have a preconceived idea of what this gallery is. It's great artwork, wonderful artist. It makes for a fun gallery experience.
And through all these years, you've been able to get to know the artists very well. One artist we're going to introduce the viewers to today is Kevin Box.
Kevin has pioneered the process of casting paper into bronze, aluminum, stainless steel. It started with origami cranes. It's moved to one of his most iconic pieces, the rock, paper, scissors.
Yeah, people love that. And once I started to learn more about him, I was amazed at what he's able to do. Let's learn more about Kevin Box.
What's exciting about origami is each piece begins with a single uncut square of paper. And to me, that's a great metaphor for life and in a moment or in a day or in a circumstance. What we do with that is really what defines us. And what we do with that blank sheet of paper every time I begin a new piece is really what defines the work, what defines the concept and the story. And ultimately, it's what defines me, as I see every work of art as a self-portrait to some degree.
That's amazing how Kevin sees a blank sheet of paper as a metaphor for life. What a conversation starter.
Here we have Hero's Horse, which is a collaboration between Kevin and Dr. Robert Lang. Here we see the sculpture, behind it on the wall, the folds that it took to make it. Together as a set, they're wonderful. On their own, they're very beautiful as well.
They are, and he takes the paper one step further, turning it into something that'll last forever, but it's not easy. Let's take a look at this process.
Casting is a very simple 35-step, 12-week process on a good day, if everything goes right. And it's expensive, it's labor intensive, it's time consuming, but it does result in a product and a final result that really has a durability and a strength to it. By the time it's gone through that intense process of becoming bronze, it's gone through for many, many steps over many, many weeks, and many different hands have touched it and participated in its formation. Every single piece of mine has a story beneath the surface. There's creases, there's wrinkles that are metaphors for decision making or consciousness, and the wrinkles being more chaos and the unused potential ready to become something else. So I employ all these different ideas. I use origami as a symbolic aspect of my work, as it can really design and develop a sense of who we are on the outside, or a form or a shape or an animal that we recognize. But if you unfold any origami design inside, the paper has a memory for every crease, and to me that's inspiring, and it reminds me of the design that's beneath the surface of things.
folded or unfolded, Kevin's work is beautiful and it must really draw people in who want to talk to you about it.
We have fun conversations with young and old alike. Seems like there's always a piece that speaks to each and every person that visits the gallery. It's artists like Kevin Box that have allowed us to stand the test of time.
Well, if you want to strike up the conversation about art, you can do so at Vail Village Arts. Sometimes art can inspire spontaneous fun. In the case of the Children's Fountain, the actions of the subject matter set an example for those enjoying this refreshing way of cooling off. This was one of the first public art displays dedicated in December of 1986. At Vail International Gallery, they love to introduce you to all kinds of art, from Russian Impressionists to emerging contemporary artists from Europe and America. They have something that will appeal to your senses. Let's take a look. Hi, Mark, great to see you again.
Good to see you too, Tricia.
Well, it's wonderful to be back in the Vail International Gallery. It's been here since 2005, but Mark, you've been in the business long before that.
Yes, we've been in the art business in Vail for close to 20 years now.
And what's so wonderful is that you represent artists from around the world, and you also have clientele from around the world. These pieces have been shipped everywhere.
That's true. We represent artists from around the world, and we ship art around the world.
But you do have some local Colorado artists, including the sculptor over here. Tell us about James Moore.
James Moore is a Colorado-born sculptor. He's influenced by Oriental art and design, but his pieces have a relevance to the area.
Oh yeah, beautiful. Neat motif here with some aspen leaves. Great little piece to put outside.
It's the Vail lamp specifically, yes.
And then tell us about this. This is a very eye-catching piece.
This is Carlo Eduardo Trost. Carlo is from Italy. He's one of our best-known artists. Carlo works in wood. He's a sculptor, but the pieces hang on the wall. They feel very light, airy, as if they're fabric, almost floating.
Oh yeah, you need to come in and check this out. A real interesting process, how he does this. And that's what's great. You can interact with the people that come on in and teach them about the art. And then another thing that your gallery is known for, the Russian Impressionists.
That's true. This is a piece by Nikolai Timkov. Nikolai Timkov is one of the most important post-World War II Soviet artists. He lived in St. Petersburg. He's what people call now a Russian Impressionist.
Well, and a lot of these works weren't even available until after the Cold War ended.
That's true. This is a market that developed post-perestroika. Americans, Europeans, and Russians collect this work now.
Okay. Well, what's interesting about Vail International Gallery, you walk in and you just think it's a little area, but then you keep on going back and back, and then in the very back, tell us about your exhibition area.
We have a plaza space, which we've had for about 8 years now, where we hold solo exhibitions for different contemporary artists. We try to exhibit and show large bodies of work by these artists so that people can really get an understanding of what they do.
Okay, let's go check it out.
All right.
Wow, Mark, this is wonderful that you have this much space to showcase different works.
We're very fortunate to have this exhibition space. It allows us to do solo exhibitions for artists and to really be creative with what we exhibit here at the gallery, which is a large part of what the gallery business is about.
Oh yeah, and you never know what you're gonna find. We've got some beautiful art over here. Tell us about her.
This is Catherine Pock. Catherine's an artist from Connecticut. She works in oil on aluminum panel, and her work is beautiful and translucent. She loves to paint water themes.
And then you have more of the whimsical. I noticed this piece over here. What is that?
This is an Italian artist, Carlo Marzuttini. Carlo works in found object material, so you have everything from a staple gun to pieces of toys, plastic, but it's a wolf head.
Oh, that's so neat. And it's so fun to see what these objects were in a previous life.
It's true.
Now, speaking of found object material, this is what your next artist is all about.
That's true. This is Bates Wilson. Bates Wilson is really a star for our gallery. I think a lot of people have seen and know his work from us. Basically, Bates works in all kinds of found object material as well. You've got highway road signs, valves, pieces of old machinery, usually to create something recognizable, such as these fish that you see here.
Yeah. And showcased in a great space.
Yeah. His work really works beautifully in large, ceilinged, contemporary settings. As you can see, we have large ceilings here, and these just hang beautifully.
Okay, and the large space over here really helps with these bigger paintings. Tell us about this artist.
This is Juan Eduardo Gomez. Juan Eduardo is originally from Bogota, Colombia. We have him right here in Vail International Gallery.
All right, that's what's so wonderful. All these different types of artists in one place at Vail International Gallery. Stop in and see anything from Russian Impressionism to international contemporary artists. Since 1989, Claggett Rae Gallery has specialized in traditional art, painting, and sculpture from living and deceased masters. Let's check in with Bill Rae and learn more. Hi, Bill. Good
hey,
to see you.
Good to see you.
Thanks for letting us come in and get the tour.
You bet. Happy to have you.
And the stories behind the art as well. And the gallery itself has been around for over 25 years, but you've been in the Valley a little bit longer.
32 now in the Valley, and our focus is on traditional American art, and the artist in front of us is one of the greats.
If you've been up to the Gondola One area, top of Bridge Street, you've seen her work. She did The Edge.
That's right. Gail Falwell is a contemporary sculptor out of Boulder and is known for doing sporting scenes and life in general in monumental form as well. This is a maquette for the NFL draft.
And I understand that you have something special for us. You brought a piece out of the vault for TVA to come and see.
We do, so come on, we'll go take a look.
Okay.
By the artist Tom Lovell.
Wow, look at this. What an amazing piece of history.
Yeah, it's a fabulous piece, and it was created by the painter Tom Lovell, and it is The Surrender at Appomattox. This piece was commissioned by National Geographic of Tom Lovell. He was one of the finest living historic illustrators in the 50s, and they knew that there was no credible painting or photograph of this event in history, so they commissioned Lovell to do it, and through all of his research, it's very historically accurate and was completed in the early 60s for the April 1965 100th anniversary of Surrender at Appomattox.
Wow, and look at the detail. They still have mud on their boots and he's all polished up.
Lovell was known for capturing the detail, and this is the epitome of a great Lovell work.
Well, you carry some other works from a Tom Lovell contemporary, Robert Lockheed.
Lockheed was a great one, and they were dear friends. So come on into the next room and we'll visit with Lockheed.
Okay. This is just amazing how many of Robert Lockheed's works you have.
Yeah, well, we own the Robert Lockheed estate, and we got involved with him because he was such a great influence on so many of the artists that we've represented over the last 30 years.
And you have everything down to his paintbrushes and his eyeglasses and his last painting he was doing of his dog for his life.
Yeah, he believed in drawing as the key to great artwork. He grew up in Canada with heavy horse teams, but always kind of followed the equine world throughout his career. And although he was a New York illustrator, he ended up later in life in Santa Fe, and horses were a major theme. You know, from painting in France to ranches in New Mexico to Hawaii to St. Croix and the Hunter Jumpers, Fairfield Hounds, wonderful piece that he did.
You mentioned that Bob was a mentor to so many, and you represent one of those artists, Wayne Wolf.
Yeah, absolutely. Bob mentored Wayne Wolf. He lived on the estate for 3 years. You know, he's absolutely the finest traditional painter of the Colorado landscape, and he captures a soulful element, much like Lockheed did. You know, they're huge paintings typically, and they capture what Colorado is.
All right, well, all these soulful elements, you can find out more and get the stories with Bill and his staff here at Claggett Rae Gallery in Vail Village. You can't help but notice this racer arcing turns down what appears to be the slopes of Vail Mountain behind it. The Edge dominates the view at Mountain Plaza as you approach Gondola One. This abstract figure of a downhill skier was inspired by the iconic Bodie Miller for his ski on the edge type of style, but it also honors the skiers and snowboarders who have trained here and have won medals in the Vail Valley. About some art-inspired fun. The Sunbird Park in Lionshead does just that and was recently recognized as one of the world's coolest playgrounds by travelandleisure.com. This is another example of a collaboration between the artist and the town of Vail and provides free family fun. Art isn't just something you hang on the wall, it can also be something that you wear. Let's check in with the jewelry artist at the Squash Blossom. Hi, Patty.
Hi,
great to
Trisha.
See you.
How are you?
Well, congratulations. The Squash Blossom has been in Vail Village for over 40 years now.
That's right. John and I opened the Squash Blossom in 1973. It was the same year we got married and graduated from college.
Okay.
So we had a lot going on.
You definitely did. And then 6 years later, you opened up the Cogswell Gallery just down the street.
Yes, our sister store. We were very proud of it.
Well, in all these years that you've been open, you've been able to really get to know your clientele and also the artists that you represent.
Yes, and we focus on that individuality, on the handmadeness, on the unique personalities of the pieces that they create.
Yeah, and it's so fun to get to know the artists. And you know, I've known Gerhan for what, over 15 years now?
Yes, a long time. And he is an icon in the jewelry world. He works with 24 karat gold. It requires ancient jewelry techniques to fashion the 24 karat.
Okay, and it is beautiful. Well, we're gonna find out more about Gerhan right now.
It starts with my overall adventure. When I decided to make jewelry, I did it for the sake of 24 karat gold. When I started investigating the ways to use that metal, I realized it's not being used today. So I took the challenge and tried to discover how did they do it in old times. I started playing with this gold and I didn't know anything about carats or purity or anything. I just enjoyed touching that piece. So I believe it was love at first sight. Totally self-taught, I started making similar tools that they used. Found out how to connect the metal. I felt like a reincarnated person. I start consciously looking for ancient lost arts, and that's what gives me the biggest pleasure still, bringing them back to life.
Patty, I just love Gerhan's ancient techniques.
Yes, and you can see the texture, the hand hammering. It's luminescent. The color of the gold is beautiful. And then when he juxtaposes it with gemstones, it's magical.
Oh, it definitely is. So pretty. And then also we have Todd Reed. He is a Colorado artist.
He is. Native Colorado, one of our favorite artists. He works with natural colored diamonds, all recycled material. Beautiful, beautiful textures on his metals. Yes.
Well, let's learn more about Todd Reed in his studio.
You know, I feel like we come under the umbrella of exquisiteness and experience. I try to always do everything as one of a kind, and I try to make it with a timeless flavor. You know, whenever I make something, I don't really take this mark, this moment in history, or what's popular, or what price might be relevant into consideration. I simply make the design that feels appropriate for whatever the emotion is that I'm trying to talk about. The design is, for me, is a real sort of internal dialogue. I'm doing it constantly. I feel like my life is design. I'm constantly drawing in sketchbooks. And when it gets to actually building a design in my workshop, I sit with my shop masters and we sort of figure out the palettes, the sizes, what I would call the tempo of it. And one of my jewelers would make each piece from start to finish all the way through.
Patty, so great to learn about Todd Reed and Gerhan, just a few of the many artists that you carry.
Yes, we do have some lovely artists here, and we would love to share their stories with you.
So check it out at either Squash Blossom or Cogswell Gallery, located in the heart of Vail Village. As you can see, there's a wide variety of art for everyone to enjoy. So stop by the galleries we showed you today and let the art spark your imagination. Thanks for watching The Gallery Stroll. I'm Trisha Swenson.